One of the key principles of learning that I've tried to incorporate into my practice is helping students become self-regulated learners who are directing their own learning, who are thinking and reflecting about what they're doing. So they're not just completing tasks, but they're actually getting better as learners when they're on their own and away from me. So one of the ways I've done this is through my conferences, when I meet with students. What I found was, after many years of doing this, that they would come in, we would work on a problem together, maybe a student had gotten stuck on an essay, and they would find a solution, and then they would leave, and both of us would be happy. I'd feel like I'd helped and supported them, they figured out what they wanted to figure out, and so we both sort of had a nice compromise there. And what I realized was that many times after these great positive conferences, students were still making the same mistake, or coming back to me at a later time saying, I got stuck again, I don't know how to do this, or worse, just not bringing it up. And what I learned to do was to build in an extra step to those conferences, to sort of force that process of reflection and metacognition, the thinking about the thinking they were doing. So once we had the conference and worked through some of the issues and talked about them, I would then stop and say, okay, so what was the problem that you originally came in with? Why did you get stuck? And what did we just do in the last 20 or 30 minutes or whatever time we'd had that helped you get unstuck? How did you solve this problem? And what I found when I started doing this was that frequently students couldn't tell me. And if I hadn't asked that question, if I hadn't asked them to stop and think about it, they likely would have run out the door happy and I would have been happy too. So this process of pausing, building into the time we have for teaching, and asking students to think about, what did you learn, how did you figure out and solve this problem, became the essential part of the conference. It wasn't really the essay that we ended up talking about, it became the process of learning. I also realized that I had to make students write down what they had learned. This was a way that they could keep a record of what they had gotten, they could come back and review it, and crucially, if they ran into that problem again, they then had that resource to go back and look. And this was a sort of representative of my evolution as a teacher as I continue to grow, thinking about not just solving the problem in that specific assignment, not just that moment in time, but helping students become learners who understand and can guide their own learning when they're long gone from my classroom.
When I was a new teacher, I did most of the heavy lifting in my classroom. I spent most of the time talking. If I asked a question and nobody knew it, I would immediately supply the answer. If a kid raised their hand and they were confused, I would come over and I would try to give them the answer right away. This meant that they were never really engaged in the struggle, and instead they knew that if they needed something, I would come and I would give it right to them. As I've developed further in my teaching practice, I've really tried to make sure that I'm more of a facilitator and that the heavy cognitive lifting falls on my students. So they know that if they have a question, I might come over and then I'll ask them to explain what they're working on or what they're trying and how it's going. And as we have that conversation, we can figure out where the misconception might be and what they can do next. I think this kind of work really helps kids identify where they feel stuck and then figure out a way to move forward. And they know that I'm there to help them, but they aren't so reliant on me. This is really important when I think about them as future learners, because I won't always be there to help them, and I need them to have tools so that they can solve their own problems more independently.
So every week we take what we call an understanding check. We check for understanding of what the kids can and can't do based on all the material from the previous months of the course. And I find that they can share a lot of their knowledge and they practice that recall of information while they take the understanding check. But the day after, they're presented with the understanding check again, and I circle where they made a mistake. I don't tell them what they did wrong. There's no points associated with it, -2 or anything like that. I just circle what they've done wrong, and then they do understanding check reflection, where they first need to explain in words what they did wrong, then they explain in words what the right solution is, and then they solve it correctly at the bottom. And it's really important for them to explain what I used to think and what I think now in their own words, maybe with the help of a peer, maybe with the help of a teacher, maybe just by looking back at their notes, before they do the correct answer, to confront that misconception that they used to have. And I think that students learn more in that reflection than they do in the rest of the week, because they've seen what they've done wrong and they've made corrections to that. And they're highly motivated to do that. When they get that test back, they look for the green star because they know that's the part that they get to make right.